And in particular, with the fire. Whenever you are going to cook, you have to make a fire with wood that can blaze and generate heat. However, it does not matter how good the wood is. No one set of wood will keep the fire going forever. You have to keep on putting in more wood to keep the fire going until your task is accomplished. Failure to replenish the fire with fresh wood will result in it burning itself out, and you are left with burning coal, which, my brothers and sisters, will eventually die and leave only ash in its place. There are times when the wood used was very good, and for those of you who are from the country, as I am, you would be familiar with the term pimento wood, or logwood, or in other case, dogwood. It will last for several days if you will cover the wood with ashes. If you wish to start, therefore, a fire to cook or otherwise, all you have to do is rid of the ashes. Get the light coal together and add more wood, and in no time you will have what we call in the western part of the island a bonfire. According to Dr. Ralph Earle, gives support in saying that anyone who has burnt wood in a fireplace knows that periodically it is necessary to add fresh fuel and sometimes to fan the embers into a flame. In the same way, the fire in the fireside needs constant rekindling to keep it alive and useful. So it is with the spiritual fire that God has given every Christian in this room. It must be constantly rekindled to keep it alive. So we ask the question, what therefore is the meaning of rekindle? For you, my friend, to fully understand and appreciate what the theme is about, one will have to grasp what it means. To rekindle, the word rekindle does not appear in the dictionary, but the word kindle does. According to the Concise English Dictionary, define it as to set alight or to start a burn, to arouse or to be aroused, to make or become bright. The Webster New Collegiate Dictionary renders it to be to set on fire, to ignite, to light, to inflame, as the passion excite, to light up or inflame, if you will. By adding therefore the prefix R-E-V to the beginning of kindle, you modify the signification of the word kindle to get rekindled, which means to recover and to restore, revive, replenish, revitalize, rejuvenate, stir up, as seen in other direction. The thought therefore is obvious that at some time in the past, you were set on fire, you were inflamed, you were ignited. Observe the word that is me. You possess the fire. But for some reason or reason, the flame in your life had died down, burned itself out, because dormant, and becomes dormant. You are not who you used to be, doing what you used to do. You are not as passionate and zealous for the things of God as as you used to. Therefore, if you don't have that zeal anymore, it means that something has gone wrong in your spiritual life. It could be that you are totally burnt out, or it could mean that some fire is still in the ashes that needs to be brushed aside, and to add more wood to the fire so that you can reignite again and to give the kind of service that it used to give to God. When we look into our church and into the life of our believers, we have seen in some people who used to be a place for God, but for some reason they have lost their fire, they have lost their passion, and you left to wonder what is happening in their lives. I want you to know tonight that you can reignite that fire and to become a place again for Almighty God. The question then asks us, several things may have caused your fire to go out. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 14, it could be negligence. Even the text says, neglect not the gift that is in thee. What God therefore has given to you, you got to continue to nurture that gift. Amen. So you want to lose it. According to Hebrews 21 verse 1, sin could be a part of your life. Let us lay aside the sin which does so easily beset us. Amen. He said, lay aside, amen, everything that could be a bother and a burden to you. It could also mean that the care of life, he that receiveth seed among the thorns, is he that hardeneth the word, heareth the word, and the cares of this world, and the diligence, even of the things of God, is on the back burner. God wants us to pay more attention to his word. It could be the spirit of witchcraft that has taken you over. The text says, O foolish Galatian, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? The Bible says the truth is essential to the Christian life. Truth is essential to you serving God. Amen. It could be laziness that has caused your fire to go out. Laziness, amen, can cause you, amen, to be in a state of slumber. Laziness could cause you to turn from the things, amen, we should urge you to seek more of God. It could be that your spiritual stagnation that is in the life of the believers, amen, but I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even, amen, unto babies in Christ. Therefore, my friend, the danger sign for any believers in growing cold toward God, you are not walking and sharing with him as you used to do. Amen. The coldness, it may not be the same for everybody. Some may feel that they are not as cold as in an ice. Some may feel that they have lost their sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. Whatever it is that caused you to lose your fire, you need to find what that thing is. Get rid of it all of your life and begin to refocus, re-strategize, even and seek for more of God. Can the church of God give him a praise in the hands of God tonight? So if the fire has gone out, you've got to turn up the heat. Even you've got to get yourself reignited to get back to the point where you used to be. Can you remember the time when you just got saved? How you hungered first for more of God. But as you grow older, it seems as if you've lost touch. You've lost interest for the things of God. Now is the time for you to get back to that place where you're now hungered and thirst for more of God. I want to suggest to the church tonight that if we as believers are going to make an impact in our communities and in our nation, we must have the power and the fire of the Holy Ghost.
If none of us can survive without the Holy Spirit, this morning text tells us that the Holy Spirit is our teacher. He will guide you into all truth. He will teach you the ways of the Lord. He will open your eyes to dangers that are before you. If you have not the Holy Spirit to guide you in these last days, you are going to find yourself in a very precarious position. But when you are sensitive to the Holy Spirit, He will open the eyes to danger that are ahead of you. And so some people, they try to harm you, and they can't understand that, they can't touch you. But it's because the Holy Spirit will wake you up, and the Holy Spirit will show you what lies ahead. And when they're expecting you to walk a particular route, the Holy Spirit's head shakes course. And so when they're expecting you to come on the taxi, they see you walking down the lane coming up. The Holy Ghost has a strategy in the life of the believers. They can't touch you because you are slippery. And it's not only because you're slippery, it's because you have the anointing of the Holy Ghost. You are slippery. God, have a way to spirit of the believers and allow them to see what the enemy have. Amen. Is another touch of the Holy Spirit. You cannot survive without Him. You cannot worship without Him rekindling the fire of the Holy Ghost in the life. It's very important. My brothers and sisters, fire is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. According to Isaiah 4 verse 4, according to Acts 2 verse 3, and the seed of the saint, according to Psalm 39 verse 3, and Hebrews 1 verse 7, among other symbols, Paul told Timothy to stir up the gift of God that is in thee, according to Dr. Alan Clark. The gift which Timothy had received was the Holy Ghost, and through him a particular power to preach and to defend the truth. Amen, my friend. There is, amen, the gift of the Holy Spirit, therefore, become important in the life of every believer. You are now called upon tonight to rekindle the original fire. Amen, the same fire that you had. The embers is there. The light coals is there. From the back into life. My soul is my maker. Worship the Lord. when you're having, they've got to watch you. Amen. Worship the Lord and be against yours, because having, oh, the sons of something, something about the Holy Ghost. I just can't explain it, but I got it. When I'm sorry, it makes me glad. When I'm weak, it gives me strength. When I'm hungry spiritually, he feeds me. Oh, I can't do without him. But there is another day when I feel like giving up. The Holy Ghost come with me and say, my brother, I will guide you. I will strengthen you. When I feel like I want to get off my rockers and tell somebody something, the Holy Ghost guide my speech. Somebody praise the Lord here. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you, you are not of yourself. There's somebody, I just need the Holy Ghost just to sit down on me just for a little while. So when they're giving me some hard times on the job, I just want the Holy Ghost to rest his hands upon me. And then I know that everything is going to be all right. And it doesn't matter what they say. It doesn't matter what they try. As long as the Holy Ghost is on my side, I have nothing to be afraid of. Somebody give the Lord a praise. It doesn't matter what hell is raging on the outside. It doesn't matter what legions are coming my way. They just can't stand in my presence. Because when they come, the scene is surrounded by the presence of the Holy Ghost. Oh, somebody raise your hand and give him a praise. I mean, I can't walk without him. For what should I must have? You say you're with me. For I be in a walk alone, I must feel his presence near me and his arms around the throne. Then tell me, what shall I fear when the Holy Ghost is beside me? Who shall I fear when I have the Holy Ghost? Who shall I run from when I can call upon him? What shall I draw for? I probably saw an AK-47 when I have the Holy Ghost. He's my weapon. He's my battle axe. He's my shield. He's my fortress. And he will not trust any neighbor. People don't have him. You better get him. Because he's a young man's keeper. He's a young girl's keeper. He's a father to the fatherless. So somebody praise him in the house. He's a mother to the motherless. He's a comforter to the lonely. When you have him, you have everything. Oh, somebody praise God in the house. See, the fire is going out. You just need to rekindle that. I tell you just a few more things before we move on to the next phase. First, like night as tonight, spiritual worship creates the atmosphere for the rekindling of the Holy Spirit. Worship is more than for a form or order. Well-spoken prayers, beautiful hymns, and the creative use of art, spiritual worship has to do with our hearts, even our interior person, our longing for God, and our openness to His Spirit. Amen. For Him to do what needs to be done in our lives. It is His job, my friend, to reprove us according to John 16, verse 8. Confession is being opened into the Spirit in Isaiah 6, verse 5. Isaiah was caught up in the atmosphere of worship in the temple when he cried, when should I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Even the same can be said of Asa in Psalm 73, who almost backslide because of being envious of the prosperity things. So foolish was I, and ignorant I was, as a beast before thee. My friend, spiritual worship creates the atmosphere for you to own up to your condition to God. And the brethren, James tells us, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that he may be what? Healed. To be effective worshipers, you've got to be at the right place. Amen. In your heart with God. Amen. To be effective worshipers, you can't just sing and you are a nice keeper. To be effective worshiper, your spirit must be free. Am I talking to anybody in the house? So when you lift up your hands, you lift up your hands with a purpose. With an open mouth and say, glory to God. It must be coming from a pure heart. Amen, somebody. Nobody's keeper can worship God in that state. Your heart must be right. Amen. Your attitude must be right. Your worship must be right. In fact, before you can worship, you've got to fix what needs to be fixed before you can enter the presence of the Lord. For the psalmist said, in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And that is right and our pleasures. You must come with clean hands. You must come with a pure heart. You must come prepared to worship and to receive from the hands of Almighty God. Can somebody give him praise and glory?
In the house of God, spiritual worship is important in the life of every believer. The Holy Spirit, therefore, is responsible for the sanctifying and the purifying process in the believer's life. But ye are washed, the text says in 1 Corinthians 6:11. But ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. And by the Spirit of our God, fire, which is symbolic of the Holy Spirit, is associated with purification of God's people. Isaiah was in worship in the temple when he was cleansed. Then fell one of the seraphim unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongue of the altar, and he laid upon my mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, and thy iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged. What we need is another dose of the baptism of the Holy Ghost to get us on the path of rightness with God. But are you ready to receive it tonight? Are you ready to get that heart in a place where you can receive from God? Is there envy? Is there jealousy? Is there malice? Is there any form, amen, of iniquity that will separate you tonight from God? If that is the case, you cannot receive from Him. But if the heart is right, if your spirit is ready, it will not take you 10 o'clock tonight to receive from Almighty God. That will be everybody. It is 8:45. And the next few minutes will be dedicated just for you to seek for more of God. By the atmosphere around us tonight, many or most of you are tattered. It is seen in your body language. But this week you said, just beat yourself and tell yourself, I am not ready for more of the Lord Jesus. If that is you tonight, if you're ready for more of Him, and say, Lord, less of me and the more of you. You should ask what you will, and it shall be done. Can I ask you to move from where you are?
be this right here tonight. Hallelujah.